Costume plays pivotal role in storytelling aspect of a movie. Delving into world of costumes is similar to uncovering a hidden layer of cinematic storytelling. They help actors to identify with the characters and directors to materialize their vision. Costume designers are not in charge of creating costumes, but outfit for characters that serves as their self-expression. Color palette, fabric choices, design, textures, all provides a nuanced visual insight into characters' personality, background, culture, time period, sometimes even subtly implying the fate. Bollywood has many memorable costumes, but sometimes it is limited to just one character, or sometimes fashion takes precedence. There are also movies where costume designing isn't limited to just one character, but have taken a holistic approach while also maintaining the aesthetic balance. I have compiled a list of those movies. There are various parameters that is taken into consideration, which we will discuss when we are talking about that movie. Also, keep in mind that I haven't seen all of the Bollywood movies, and it is my perception. And just like every perception, it is also biased. So within this series, if you feel a movie is missing, please let me know. Embarking on our Bollywood iconic costume design journey with magnum opus of director Kiasif, Mughal-E-Azam. He took 14 years to complete this movie. Production commenced in 1944 during British colonial rule and was released in the year 1916 in an independent India. The movie is based on a 1922 play titled Anarkali by Imtiaz Ali. It unfolds the tale of star-crossed lovers, Prince Salim, played by Dilip Kumar, and court dancer Anarkali, played by Madhubala. Mughal Emperor Akbar, who is Salim's father, played by Prithviraj Kapoor, is against this match because of societal hierarchies, which causes a conflict leading to a war between father and son. Kiasif wanted to capture the grandeur of the Mughal era, paying attention to every detail, whether it is music, set, or costume. B.N. Trivedi was in charge of the costume department, and they collaborated with different artisans from various parts of India. Skilled tailors were sourced from Delhi to craft the costumes. Expert embroiderers from Surat were engaged for Zardozi embroidery. Hyderabadi goldsmiths fashioned the jewelry, and footwear was commissioned from Agra. Venturing with Anarkali's costume journey, we first see her posing as a marble statue, making her look like an angel. When complimented with the saying, she introduces herself as Kaniz, meaning servant. Her real name is Nadira, an Arabic name meaning precious. Impressed with her beauty, courage, and humbleness, Akbar makes her a court dancer and gives the name Anarkali, meaning pomegranate blossom. In the subsequent scene, Anarkali plays the role of Radha, dancing in celebration of the Hindu festival Janmashtami. Her attire consists of an orange ghagra, red choli with a yellow orni. This ensemble was prevalent among royal Hindu women of that era, exemplified by Queen Jodha Bai, portrayed by Durga Khote in the film. Queen Jodha Bai was a Hindu princess. She is the wife of Emperor Akbar and mother of Prince Salim. Throughout the movie, she is seen in elaborately embroidered ghagra, choli, and orni, maintaining historical accuracy except for the method of tying the orni. Historical paintings indicate that if she had been tying her orni this way, she would have also worn a patka. Another method was to pleat one end of orni and tuck it into the ghagra, creating the illusion of a patka. In this particular scene, Prince Salim envisions Anarkali as his prospective wife. Sort of the costume makes it easier for him to imagine, considering she is in similar attire to that of his mother and the present queen. And let's not forget, he is the one who suggested Anarkali to play the role of Radha. The most iconic costume from the movie, or more aptly entire Bollywood, is this sky blue pleated and flared kurta with a red jacket, pajama, patka, cap, and a small red ovni. She wears this dress while proclaiming her love for Prince Salim. But neither this outfit is historically accurate, bearing the pajama, nor was this designed particularly for this movie. We will come to this point later. Now, if this is not historically accurate, then what did Mughal women actually wear in the 16th century? This painting is from Akbar's biography, depicting him enjoying a dance performance. If the costume had been historically accurate, or if Anarkali had actually existed. Yeah, she is a fictional character. She would have worn Peshwas, like the dancers in the painting. As you can see, the Peshwas used to have longer length, reaching up to ankle, had a front opening, allowing space to wear patka over pajama, unlike patka over kurta as shown in the movie. The decision to opt for patka over kurta might have been influenced by the way men wore patka over their jama. Also, the kurta is closed, so it seemed a logical solution. Another thing is that it can help to hide the edging of the jacket. One thing the movie got absolutely accurate is the variation in the style of pajama in terms of textures or print. Another illustrative example to understand the type of peshwas worn by the Mughal women at that era is to look at peshwas recreated by Bhanu Athiya, inspired by miniature painting from the 17th and 18th century for the Air India calendar. Coming to the later point about the origin of this ensemble, I could not find a concrete answer for the origin of the style of wearing kurta with a jacket. However, even before the release of Mughal-E-Azam, actors in many movies wore this ensemble while portraying the character of a courtesan. This particular style might have developed during the early 20th century, probably taking inspiration from Victorian waistcoat, hence the name waistcoat. It is also economical, considering both are separate pieces, allowing them to style and restyle in various ways. The cut and shape of the tightly fitted bodice also accentuate the women's silhouette and give the effect of raised bosoms. It also makes me wonder, is it possible that there could be an influence of stays or corset? By the way, this also busts the very popular myth that this ensemble has always been called Anarkali Suit. It was also called Peshwas, and the term Anarkali Suit may have likely gained prominence after 2004 when the colored version of the movie was re-released. And who can forget the era of Anarkali Suit, right? Especially between the year 2010-12. Almost every Indian designer was designing kurtas with this particular cut and style, and every other celebrity were donning this style. Even today, any gathered, pleated, flared kurtas are generalized under the nomenclature Anarkali Suit. There was another character in the movie who stands antithesis to Anarkali but also created a trend. That too after release of the movie. I'm of course talking about the character of Bahar, played by Nigar Sultana. Want to hear something ironic? In the original play, she is called Dilaram, meaning solace to heart, and she is far from it. She serves as the chief court dancer in the court of Emperor Akbar and thus has access to better costume compared to other dancers. After Jodha Bai, her costume is the most embellished one. Moreover, her extravagant costume, jewelry, and the subtle nuances of her sartorial choice reflect her fervent ambition to marry Prince Salim and, more importantly, ascend to the position of the future queen. She is often seen donning an ornate cap with feather, which was specially designed for the movie by drawing inspiration from Chagatai hat worn by Mughal royal women. Her deliberate selection of headwear serves as a visual declaration of her desire to stand shoulder to shoulder with the royal women, also trying to establish herself as an important person in the court. After the release of the movie, this signature ornate cap became famous as Nigar cap, named after the actress. Now compare Bahar's cap to Anarkali's cap. Anarkali wears it only twice, the first time while meeting Salim and the second time while dancing. She prefers it with an orni, representative of her demure nature. The outfits donned by Anarkali and Bahar in the climax scene of Mughal-E-Azam are also a visual testament to understand their inherent character. Anarkali is wearing a simple white peshwas, while Bahar is wearing an ornated black peshwas, the antithesis of each other, an interplay of light and darkness. Anarkali is courageous, humble, virtuous, and loyal. In contrast, Bahar, though courageous, is deceitful, manipulative, a conspirator, and an instigator of this whole drama. Anarkali represents light, while Bahar symbolizes darkness. In the original play, Salim strangles Bahar after being taunted by Anarkali's sister Suraya for being a coward. So, in a way, the black outfit also represents her upcoming fate. One of the grim scenes in the movie depicts Anarkali's imprisonment. To achieve authenticity, Madhubala was given heavy chains, resulting in bruises. Additionally, she abstained from eating for days to portray the depth of the character's suffering, leading to her being bedridden for several days. She confronted challenges with night schedules and intricate dance sequence despite medical advice to avoid them. Following the movie, the combined mental and physical exhaustion prompted her to contemplate retirement. Now, in terms of men's costume, the movie captures the essence of the style quite accurately. During that period, men typically wore jama, a garment fastened with lappets. But distinction existed in the way Hindu and Muslim men fastened it. Hindus on the left side and Muslims on the right. The film portrays this detail, showing Muslim royalty like Akbar and Salim fastening on the right side, while Hindu royalty like Man Singh and Durjan Singh do so on the left. The minor deviation lies in the fastening mechanism. Lappets, ranging from simple to elaborate, were used to tie jamas, whereas in the movie, the fastening isn't done using the tying method, and it is there just for adornment. Just like women, men also had a range of options for pajamas in terms of color, textures, or print. However, in the movie, they are portrayed wearing predominantly white. In the casual scene, Akbar and Salim are also seen wearing a jacket over jama, which looks like choga, again a prevalent outerwear during that era. Salim also wears a short embroidered jacket, a departure from historical accuracy. And just like women's jacket, they are inspired by Victorian era waistcoats worn by British men. And yeah, they are also called buskirt. While researching, I got to know about an anecdote related to expensive pearl-laden shoes that Akbar was to wear in a scene, probably worth million today. He Asif was suggested to use imitations, since the shoes would not be prominently featured in close-ups. He responded, "Your camera may not see the shoes significantly in the shot, but when my Akbar wears those shoes and walks, he will feel every inch an emperor, and that expression is what the camera will capture." These attention to details has made this costume iconic and memorable. Considering it was the first time in Bollywood such attention to details were paid, K. Asif understood the significance of using costume to tell the nuances of character. And this was the analyzation of the costume of the first movie from the series. We will continue the journey of discussing iconic Bollywood costumes with the next movie in the next video. But please let me know in the comment section about your theory or perception about the costume, or even the story of you discovering the movie Mughal-E-Azam or its song, or perhaps getting an Anarkali suit for the first time.